Welcome to this course where you're going to learn about .NET Maui while creating a context application in .NET 7. So these are the technologies we're going to cover in this course. Of course, we're going to learn a lot about .NET Maui. We're going to use event-driven approach first in order to quickly pick up the technologies in .NET Maui. And then we're going to move on to use MVVM to create the application. We're going to also adopt the clean architecture so that we can have a use case-driven and plugin-based architecture that we're going to rely on when we need to create scalable, maintainable applications in real-world scenarios. We're also going to use SQLite to persist the data. Last but not least, we're going to work on creating and consuming ASP.NET minimum API within .NET Maui. Now let's take a look at the mobile application that we're going to create. This is a context application. We can add a contact, enter the name, email, phone number, and so on. We can also delete the contact. We can edit contact, update it, and also we can search contacts. And you can see that we actually have field validation functionalities. So this is not just a CRUD application. Now let's take a look at the different sections in this course. First section, we have the introduction section where we're going to learn about the basics of .NET Maui. And we are going to directly work on creating the context application with the event-driven approach, where we're going to touch on most of the aspects in .NET Maui. And then we are going to adopt the clean architecture, refactor the code, so that our application is going to be more maintainable, more scalable. And after that, we're going to use the MVVM approach, because if you actually want to become a mobile application developer to write some applications in the company, you're going to see there are a lot of existing applications that are created with this MVVM approach. Right. After that, we're going to learn about how to persist data in SQLite. Right. Because we use the clean architecture, so we're creating data stores as plugins. So you're going to learn about SQLite, and also you're going to learn about the plugin-based clean architecture, which is going to be very cool. And then finally, we're going to learn about minimum API in ASP.NET Core. And this is all in .NET 7. You're going to learn to create a web API. And later, you're going to learn about consuming the web API. Again, this is based on clean architecture. To consume the web API, we also create a plugin. So by the end of the course, you're not only going to be able to independently create a mobile application with .NET Maui, but also learn about a lot of architecture, design patterns, dependency injections, all of that. So without further ado, let's jump into the course. The first several videos are free. I hope I'll see you in the course. In this video, we're going to talk about what is .NET Maui and what is the difference between .NET Maui and Xamarin Forms. So if we look at this .NET Maui documentation from Microsoft, you can see that it basically allows you to create one code base but target different type of platforms. So in most cases, you don't have to write different codes for different platforms. You only need to write your code in one place, and that one place can be deployed to different platforms. You don't have to make specific changes for the specific target platform. But isn't that the same as Xamarin Forms? No, it's not really the same. Once you create the .NET Maui project, you see in Visual Studio, there's only one project. That one project allows you to target different platforms. Whereas in Xamarin Forms, right, so this is the Xamarin Forms documentation from Microsoft, you can see that for different platforms, right, this is for Android and this is for iOS. These are just examples. You have different projects, right? So there's going to be one project for Android, and then another project for iOS. And there could be other projects for Windows phones, UWPs. But Xamarin Forms also has a shared code base here, right? That is itself another project. Right? So when you create Xamarin Forms application, you will see different projects, right? Many projects. One of them is the most important one, which is this shared application code. It contains all of the logic and the forms. But then you will see also another project for Android, another project for iOS, another project for UWP, another project for Windows Phone, for example. So they're kind of similar, but very different, right? Practically very different. So let's actually take a look at the individual studio, how it looks like. Right? This is Xamarin Forms Hollow World application. Right? You can see that it contains many, many projects. Right? And this, the first one, the portable one, this is the project that contains the shared application code. Right? Most of your logic, most of your activities, your coding activities will go here. Right? And then you have different projects. You have to run them differently if you want to target Android. You know, you set this one, this project, as the startup project, right? And then you run the application from here, right? If you want to target iOS, then you have to set iOS project as the startup project, and then you start your project from there. Here's the .NIMAUI application. You only actually have one project. And this one project allows you to target different platforms. So practically, they're very, very different. And so this is what I want to point out in this video. And starting from next one, we're going to set up the Visual Studio environment in order to allow us to create the .NIMAUI application. In this video, we're going to try to go through the steps of setting up the environment in Visual Studio 2022. In order to make your Visual Studio ready for creating .NIMAUI applications. Right, so this is the Visual Studio installer. Right, you can find it in the search area. Once you find it, go to your Visual Studio 2022. Right? In my case, I have the Community Edition for 2022. Once you update to the latest, click on the Modify button, and then you will need to find the desktop and mobile application part, right, this part, and it says .NET multi-platform application UI development, and you need to check it, and then you just need to install it, right? In my case, I have already done it. And once you've done it, you will be able to create a .NIMAUI application. So once you updated your Visual Studio 2022 and then you installed .NIMAUI, now you can create the project. Right, so let's go through the process. Creating a new project. And then these are my recent project templates. But if you just installed .NIMAUI for the first time, then you wouldn't be able to see these. So what you can do is you can go to the search bar and then you can type MAUI. And then you'll be able to see a list of applications. We're going to select the first one, which is .NIMAUI app. Right, and then click on the next one. And we are going to name the solution contacts because we're going to create a contacts application. And I like to name the solution after the purpose of the application. So in this case, it's a contacts app. So I'm just going to call it contacts. And then the project, I'm going to have the purpose and then the type of project. In this case, it's a MAUI app. And then I'm going to click on the next one. I'm going to select .NET 7. I'm going to click on Create. Here you have it. This is the only project you see in this solution, right? For now. Later, we're going to add different projects, which mainly .NET MAUI class libraries to support us to create applications in different layers, right? We can't just put everything in one project. No company does that. So you will have to learn to separate different things in different layers, which will reside in different projects, different class libraries. So in this case, what you can do is first you can run it in Windows machine, right? But in this course, we're going to mainly target Android. But if you do prefer to run it in Windows, then you may encounter kind of like an error like this. Right, so it says Windows Defender Firewall blocked the broker.ex. So you will need to allow access. Right, you need to click on the allow access in order to be able to deploy your application to Windows environment. Very likely, it will prompt you to say that you know you have to enable developer mode for Windows. Right, and then you just click on the settings for developers, right? You will see this screen and then you just click on this button to turn on the developer mode. This will enable you to deploy and run applications in Windows mode. That's how you set up the environment for Windows machine. But what I would try to do is to go to the Android Device Manager right? And then you will need to add a emulator. In my case, I'm using Pixel 5, right? API 3031. You just need to install the same thing. You can use different mobile phone emulators, but I chose this one. And it's possible that you will have to turn on Hyper-V, right, in order to accelerate the emulator so that it runs faster, right? So this is the options that you need to choose when you go to Windows Features. You turn on these features in order to enable Hyper-V to accelerate your Android emulator. So once you're all done, then you would be able to go to Android emulator, and then you can change this to target your selected Android mobile emulator, right? So in this case, if we run the application, it's going to take a while for the first time, and then it will be way faster because after build, it will identify the differences between this build and next build, and it will only deploy the differences instead of the whole thing. Right, for the first time, it's going to compile, and then it's going to deploy everything into the emulator. That's going to take a few minutes, depending on how fast your machine runs. You know, finally it deploys to the application, and next time it's going to take shorter time. But you can see that the application is deployed to my Pixel 5 emulator, and then everything runs, you know, normally. And in the next video, we're gonna go inside the solution of in Visual Studio and see the project structure. In this video, let's take a look at the project structure of a .NET MAUI application. Okay, so this is the application that we just created. When you look at this application, it seems like MAUI program.cs is the start point of the application, right? And it does look like it's trying to create an app, but let's think about this. This application can be deployed to different devices, different type of devices, includes Android, iOS, and whatnot. So how can this one program.cs be used in different platforms? They must have their specific way to launch an application, right? So this is not actually the starting point. The starting point is in the platform's folder. So if you look at the Android folder, you would have a main application.cs, and then you can see that the main application.cs actually uses the MAUI program. So if we right click and go to definition, we can see that this goes back to the MAUI program.cs file, and this is the create MAUI app static method, right? Static function. Let's go back and take a look at iOS, right? iOS is a different way to launch the app. That's a main app, but then it uses the app delegate. And if you go into the app delegate, a similar way of launching the program is being used, right? You can see that it also calls the same static method. Of course, if you go into other devices, right, this one would be similar to iOS, it uses the app delegate. And then when you go to app delegate, it uses the method. Right, you can see that every single platform points to this MAUI program.cs. So our work mostly are not in here, right? So we can just kind of ignore this for now, right? So if you have any specific platform code that you want to write, then you can go over here. But in .NET MAUI, you don't usually encounter that situation very often. So most of your code, starting up code, will be here, and mainly about dependency injection, which we'll cover later. Practically, everything would be starting from here, right? We don't have to worry about the platform's folder. Practically, everything starts from this static method, which will be invoked from different platforms, right? It starts from here, and then you can see that it's trying to create an application, a .NET MAUI application, right? So we can go to this app. This is the next place where we need to look at, right? So this app from the front end, which is the XAML end, it doesn't have much. It has a bunch of resources we don't have to focus on. But let's go back. We can see that it has a main page, every single .NET Maui application has a main page, and it's just similar to Xamarin Forms. It has a main page, but we have a special type of main page, which is called App Shell. So for .NET Maui, a shell application is created by default, right? Which uses this shell page. You don't have to do it this way, but this is provided to you as a default option, which I actually like it very much. The shell becomes the main page, and when you go to the shell, you can see that it has the shell content, right? And then when you go to the backend, there's nothing on it. So the shell itself is an opinionated way for organizing all of your pages. In this case, it points to the main page, the route to the main page, which is just a page. You don't have to call it main page. It's just a page. One thing may be confusing, and you have to understand that this main page is just referring to this one, main page, right? This main page. And then if you go to the code behind, you can see that this main page is a content page, right? The type is content page. Whereas if you go to the app code behind here, this main page is the application's main page, right? It's a member of the application. And the type of that is a page. They are completely different objects. They are completely different objects. So don't get confused. This main page is not referring to this main page. So we have iOS, we have Android, and we have Windows, for example. And of course we can have more, but everything actually goes into this Maui program.cs. We don't have to even worry about the different platforms. We kind of ignore this layer. What really matters is that our code starts from Maui program.cs. And then this goes to app. This app represents our application, and every application needs to have a main page. And in .NET Maui, the default main page is the shell page, which is the app shell. You don't have to do it this way, but this is the default structure that is provided. With this app shell, it organizes all of the other pages. For example, we may have page 1, page 2, page 3, page 4, and no matter what type of hierarchy you actually have, let's for example, page 1 has two child pages, like two children, and page 2 and page 1 are on the same level. Each single one of these pages will need to register to App Shell, at least for routing purpose. So this is the project structure of the .NET Maui application that is provided out of the box. Again, App Shell and the way that it organizes the pages is a opinionated way for organizing the application and all of the pages. You don't have to do it this way. You can create your own page and make that page as the main page. But in this course, we are going to utilize the different functionalities that is provided by a shell page. So let's look at the documentation from Microsoft, right? A shell page provides four different features, right? Fundamental features. But for me, I'm mainly focused on this one, right? Because the other three different features, they are kind of implemented through this flyout and tabs, right? This is the flyout, and then you have different tabs, and then you have your search bar here. If you don't like this kind of UI structure, you can still use shell application for at least registering different routes for different pages, and then navigate to those pages with a URL-based navigation scheme, which we'll cover later. Okay, so this is everything for this video, the project structure of a .NET Maui application. I'll see you in the next one. A .NET Maui application is a stateful application that has a user interface. What is a stateful application? It just means that it needs to maintain a state. And a state, it just represents the data, right? It's just the data. So in this type of application, we have three basic elements that all developers need to deal with while we are creating the application. So of course, the first one is the state, which is the data. And then the view, which represents the user interface. The state will need to be displayed in the view. Let's put a user here. And then user will then interact with the view. And then that generates the event. And then developers will handle the event, which will in turn change the state. And then the cycle goes on, which means when the data is changed, the view gets updated again. And then the user plays with the user interface and triggers the event. And then the state is updated again. So cycle goes on and on. Okay, so let's take a look at the application ourselves and see where are the three different elements in the main page. So this is the main page. We can see that we have this data here, right? Which is the state. And then the state is not initially displayed on the user interface. Where's the user interface? It's represented by the XAML file. So this is the XAML file. We have this initial state that is not actually displayed here. It just says click me, right? Once the user clicks on the button, which triggers the event, then the event is handled by this onCounterClicked event handler. Then the state is changed and the state is manually assigned to the text property of the button. So that displays the state on the user interface and completes the cycle, right? And the user can choose to interact with the user interface, which means that the user can click on the button again, and then this whole cycle goes on and on. But this particular way of handling the events is called event-driven development. Whereas in .mui, we have another way, which is MVVM. These two different ways handles all three different aspects of the development cycle, right? The state, the view, and the event handling. In this particular case, the event-driven mode, each event will have an event handler in the code behind of the user interface, right? So this is the code behind, and this is the user interface file, right? The event handlers are all in here, and then we just make the logic happen in here and then manually update the user interface. MVVM will be covered later, which is more organized, but I just want to cover all these three different elements today so that we have a map for our learning process. In the previous video, we talked about that a .NET MAUI application has three essential elements. And in this video, let's focus our attention on the view, which is the UI element. So a .NET MAUI application may have different pages. In this video, let's focus our attention on a page, right? What is really on a page? So let's take a look at this main page. We have the XAML file and a XAML.cs file. The XAML file represents the UI, and the XAML.cs file is the code behind, which provides logic and feeds data to be presented in the UI. Focus our attention on the UI part. We can see that it's a page. It's a content page, right? Essentially, it's just a page. So what is a page? .NET MAUI application may have different pages. It's basically just referring to that area that occupies the whole user interface. So this is a page. And then inside the page, there could be different UI elements like buttons, images, list views, and whatnot. So if we put them in a diagram to express this more clearly, we have a page, right? And then inside the page, we may have different UI elements. Under other development frameworks, like web development frameworks, we call these UI elements controls, right? But inside .NET MAUI, we call these UI elements views. This view is different from what we mentioned last time. This view in last time diagram is a generic term that refers to UI. Here, these elements are called views. Each one of them is a view. This is specific to .NET MAUI. Therefore, in .NET MAUI, we have a page, and inside that page, we can have one or more views. However, if you put these views directly under a page, you will get an error. Right? For example, we come over here, we look at our main page. We can see we have image, we have labels, right? We have buttons. These views, each one of them is a view, is actually under a layout. Well, this scroll view is also a layout. The layout is directly under a page. So therefore, we cannot put multiple views under a page. We have to put them under a layout and then put that layout under a page. In this case, it's scroll view. And then inside the scroll view, it has another layout, right? It doesn't have to have another layout, but in this case, it has another layout. So you have to remember that directly under a page, there can be only one layout. Under that layout, there can be more layouts, views. In fact, a layout itself is also a view. So let's actually go to the definition of this vertical stack layout. You can see that it's derived from Stackbase, and then Stackbase direct from layout. And if you go to layout, it's actually derived from view, right? And if you go to, for example, the image, we go to the definition, you can see it is derived from the view. So a layout is actually a view. You can't see the layout, but it's used for organizing the individual views, group them together, provide layout to them. So therefore, what you really have is inside a page, there is a layout, right? So this is the layout, and then inside the layout, you can have multiple views. And also remember that a layout is also a view. So therefore, inside a layout, you can have multiple layout. And then inside those layout, you can have multiple views. So the structure is therefore like this. You have a page, one page, right? And then a page can have single layout, right? And then inside the layout, you can have multiple views. If we remove this layout, right, let's try to remove this layout. You can actually see compile time error. Here is that the property content is not set more than, it's set more than once, right? So what we're trying to play the elements inside a content page, which is actually trying to set the content property, but it's complaining that it's set more than once. That means that actually inside a content, like inside a page, the content element can only contain one view, right? This is what it's trying to complain. So therefore, you can only put a layout here. You don't have to have the scroll view. Any layout will do. So if we delay the scroll view, it still works, right? At least it doesn't complain anymore. But in this case, it just want to let it scroll as well. That's why it added a scroll view. So that's the first concept I want you to remember, right? Which is this: a page contains layout, and then layout contains views. The second concept I want you to know is the namespaces, right? So we have these namespaces. What does it mean? You can see these are XMLs, right? XML elements. But why scroll view is recognized? But if I put scroll view 1, then it's not, right? So automatically the closing element becomes scroll view 1, but it's complaining that scroll view 1 was not found. So these namespaces are provided here. It's exactly like the namespaces that are provided in C sharp, right? So for example, namespace.netmaui. If we don't have namespaces.netmaui, even So let's delete this. You can see even the button doesn't even recognize, right? So we put namespaces so that we provide definition for our keyword that we use inside a programming language, right? So in XAML, it's another programming language that is created for .NET MAUI, right? But where do these keywords come from? They come from namespaces. In this particular case, it came from the stateful namespace, right? It's XML namespace, which is Microsoft.NET MAUI. And then you have extension, right? So for example, if you want to give it a name, you can say x.name, and then you can say image1, right? So you give it a name. But the name itself, it doesn't come from the default namespace. This is default namespace. You see, if I remove X, then the name is not actually recognized, right? That means that this name property doesn't come from the default namespace. It comes from this Microsoft XAML namespace. So therefore, if you want to give it a name, you have to use X colon. And then if you want to refer to anything that is within the main page, for example, this button click event, which you can actually go to definition, and then that immediately jumped over to onCounterClicked. So it knows this onCounterClicked method in the code behind just because we're referencing the class. If we remove this, we will see that if we right click here and then go to definition, it doesn't know where to go. Right, and so if we put it back, now if we go down and try to do the same thing, we go to definition, it will be able to jump over to the code behind. So that's namespace, and it's a very important concept that you would want to know, because later when you code, you thought that this is going to work, but it's not being recognized. That's just because you may need to add some namespaces. Okay, that's everything I want to cover in this video. I'll see you in the next one. In this video, let's talk about URL-based navigation. We are going to have three pages in this context application, right? We're going to have a main context page that is going to show a list of contexts. And then we'll be able to navigate to edit contact page where we can edit the page or even just view the contact details and then navigate back. Right? And then we have another page, add contact page, where we navigate to add a new contact and then navigate back. So let's jump into Visual Studio and create these three pages so that I can demonstrate you how to do the URL based navigation. We can just start with adding these three different empty pages. So let's go to create a folder. Let's call it views. Right. And then we are going to have to add a new item, and here we just type in page, then you can see contact page. Let's select the XAML page. C# page, that means that you are not going to have a XAML representation as a front end. Everything has to be added as C# class. So I would personally prefer to use XAML so that the front end and the back end are nicely separated, right, decoupled. So let's select this and let's call it contact page. So this is the main page. And then you can see that it has a title here. And let's just delete the page. And then we're going to add another one. So we can add another one, we can call it added contact page. And then here we can just add a space and then delete page again. And then last but not least, we're going to add another one, and this is going to be called add contact page. And again, we're going to add a space here and then delete the page. Now we have these three different pages, but if we run the application, we're not going to see these three different pages. So let's start running it. So just hit a 5, right, to run the application in debug mode. Run the application in debug mode, it triggers the hot reload for .NET MAUI, so that any changes you make in the XAML file will be reloaded and redisplayed in the application immediately. You can see the application runs, but no matter where I go, right, like it doesn't show those three different pages. So before we implement the URL-based navigation, let's try the hot reload. So let's go to the main page, because this is actually just displaying the main page, right? And if we change anything, for example, we change hello world to hello.net Maui, and then if we save it and come back over here, you can see that immediately the change is reflected. Let's stop debugging, because we are going to make some code behind changes. The code behind changes will not be reflected immediately, so it needs a recompile and redeployment. So let's go to the app shell. Like we mentioned before, the shell provides URL-based navigation. And inside the constructor is a perfect place for us to register the routes. Right? In order to jump to any pages with URL-based navigation, we first need to let the system know that we have these routes that points to these pages. So one of the way to do it is to say routing, right? There is this routing, and then we can say register route. And then here you can see that the first parameter is a string, and that represents the key of the route or the name of the route, but it has to be unique, right? For that, we can say name of the class name, so name of the context page, right? So context page, we can do a control dot to import the namespace, and then here we need to provide the type. Okay, so let's go to the second signature. So the second parameter is the type. We can use type of context page. So basically now the inside .NET MAUI, the system, it has a key and value pair. So the name of the page is the key. Right? It doesn't have to be the name of the page. You can call it anything, but it's easier if we just use name of the page, right? Because that's usually unique. And then the type. So later when you navigate to this page, it knows the type of the page, and then it will be able to construct dynamically on demand in the memory, and then show you the page. That's just because it knows the key value pair, it knows which type to instantiate, right? So we have another two routes, so we're gonna register the other two routes. So name of edit contact page, and then last one is we're gonna have name of and then add contact page, and then they suggest me to have the rest, so I don't have to type everything. Okay, now I register these three different routes, right? So let's demonstrate how we can navigate to these three different routes. First of all, I don't want the main page to be the home page. I want the context page to be the main page. To do that, we can go to the front end of the shell, right? Here, it registered the routes in a different way. So now I can say context page, and then here it has this local, and then you can see that this local is a namespace, right? Extended namespace, where I can say local, and then I can see what's defined under that namespace. But our context page is not under the local namespace. Our namespace for the context page is under context.maui.views, right? context.maui.views. So for that, we can say views equals CLR namespace, right? And then here we can say contacts.my.views. So it shows this directly here, right? So now we can use views to provide the type information, right? Views colon, then you can see those three different pages that we added earlier. So we are going to use context page. So basically this is the same thing as routing.registerRoute. This route is the key, provides the name. If we navigate to definition, you can see this is a string, right, for the shell content. And then here is the type of that. So we provide a name and we provide the type. Now, if we run the application, we will be able to see the context page, but there's nothing on it. What we can do is we are going to add two buttons just for demonstration purpose. Later, we're going to remove it. So here there's a label already, but we're going to add a button. And then the button text is to say, go to, just call it add or added contact. And then we are going to have another button and we're going to call it add contact. And when we click on the added contact, we want to go to added contact page. For that, we will need to have an event handler to handle the click event. To distinguish between this button and this button, we will need to provide a name first. Like I mentioned last time, you need to use the X extension to give it a name, because the name property is not in the default namespace. So here, I can call it BTN edit contact, right? And then here, I can call it BTN add contact. Now, if I go to clicked, I can tap to add an event handler, and that will have our name in it, right? And this, what it does is that it's not only just created this, it just assigned this string to this property, but also created a event handler in the code behind. It's empty, of course, for now. In here, we're going to say new event handler instead of select existing one. We're going to say new event handler. And then now it has our name in it, and then created another event handler here. Like I mentioned before, we are going to create this context application twice. The first time we're going to create it with event-driven development. The second time we're going to use MVVM pattern. The event-driven development is easier to learn, so it gives us a lot of opportunity to understand .NET MAUI. And then we're going to move on to MVVM, which is usually used in different companies for mobile development, right? With Xamarin Forms or .NET MAUI. So that's why we have these two different ways of creating the same application. So let's continue. Here, we're going to demonstrate how to do the URL-based navigation. We are going to say shell.current, right? So this is the current shell, which is, let's go to definition. You can see that this current shell is a static member of the shell class, right? But it refers to the shell that we have in here, right? So therefore it knows all of the registered routes. So we are going to say go to async, right? And where are we going to go? So here you can see that the first parameter is shell navigation state, but it's really just the string. But it's not any string. It is the key of a particular route. So we can just say name of, right, edit contact page. Then it's very simple. It's just that we are navigating to this edit page. And then we can do the same thing here. You can say shell, right, current. We find the current shell. And then That current shell knows our register route. So we need to provide a key here. In this case, it's contact page. And that's it. Let's see whether it works or not. Okay, now we can see that the page is displayed. Right? Instead of the original main page, we're displaying the context page. Right? We can see the two buttons are connected to each other. So we will need to fix that first. So let's go to the context XAML. And then this is vertical stack layout. What it means is that all of the views inside the layout will be vertically stacked on top of each other, right? But it has a spacing. It has a spacing property here. So let's put 5 here, right? It's a unit. It's not pixels or anything. It's just a special unit. And then let's go here. You can see that it's nicely separated now. Now we can click on the edit contact button. You can see that it navigated to the add contact page, right? And if we click on the back button, it will navigate back. And then we go to add contact. You can see it went to the add contact page. Click on the back arrow, it goes back. Another thing we can do is, for practice purpose, we can add another button here. And we can give it a name. And we can call it BTN cancel, right? And the text is cancel. This will take us back to the context page, so we don't have to use the back arrow. We are going to add a clicked event handler, right? And then we're going to do the same thing on the edit page. We're going to add a button. I'm going to give it a name. I'm going to call it BTN edit. BTN cancel, and then we are going to get a text and call it cancel, and now we're gonna create the event handler. You can see that it automatically knows that this has to be rebuilt. So actually, let's stop debugging, then create the event handler, right? And now we can go to the code behind here, and then here, we can do it a little bit differently. We can do shell, current, and then go to async. This is the same, but here we can use dot dot. So dot dot, you know, in folder structure, dot dot means the parent. So we can use dot dot here to say that we're gonna navigate back to the parent page, right, which is the context page. So we can use that and copy this. And go to over here, and we can say shell current go to async dot dot. It's the same thing. Now let's run the application. So let's go to edit contact. Right, we can see we are on edit contact page. Click on cancel. This takes us back to contacts. Go to add contact. Click on cancel. Also takes us back to contacts. Another thing that I want to point out is that if you want to use the actual name instead of the dot dot to go to the context page, right, you can't just use name of context page. Why is that? That's because if we go to the shell page, you can see that the context page is the first page, which is basically the main page. Right, for main page shell navigation, when you use URL based navigation, you have to provide the absolute path, right? So the way that we are navigating in context page here, we are just using relative path, right? The absolute path, it starts with slash slash. So let's go to the documentation. You can see that this is the documentation of shell navigation, right? You can see that the first level is the root, right? And it starts with slash slash. So if you want to go to the main page, you have to specify the slash slash. So let's go here, right? If you do this, it's not going to work. So how is it going to work? You can use string interpolation here. So we're going to say // and then curly braces. So this provides the absolute pass, and this is going to work. Okay, so let's run the application. And then let's go to add contact. Right, so now we are on the add contact page right here. And then clicking on the cancel button, this will take us back to the contacts page. So again, to navigate back to the main page, you have to provide the absolute pass, or you can use dot dot. That's everything for this video. I'll see you in the next one. We are going to start creating a contact list on the contacts page. And what we are going to use is ListView. So in this video, let's start learning the basics of using ListView. So a few videos ago, I mentioned that there can be only one view on the top level inside a page. So in this case, you can see that on the top level is the vertical stack layout, and everything is inside it. We don't need the buttons. We don't need the labels. We will talk about the layout later. Today, we are going to use ListView. So we can say ListView. And if we run it, you can see that there's nothing on the screen. But ListView has background. So we turn on the background, like we give the background some color. For example, ground color equals blue. We can see that everything become blue. Right? That means that ListView occupies the whole page. You need to know that ListView is, it's not like when there's nothing in the list, it's not occupying the whole screen. You need to know that it always occupies the whole screen. I like to give it a transparent background because in different devices, for example, not devices, different type of operating systems like Android or iOS, the background's color sometimes is slightly different. So to make it consistent, just make it transparent. Also that you need to know that ListView, it automatically has the scroll functionality. So later when you know that there's some such a thing that called scroll view, right? So you can actually see a scroll view is a layout. Scroll view is a type of layout. Of course, there can be only one root view in here. So scroll view and list view, they're kind of conflicting with each other. You can only have one top level. So if you put list view inside a scroll view, it's going to work, but it doesn't make sense because list view itself already has the functionality of scrolling. If you add another scrolling functionality on top of it, it's going to affect each other. So when you have a list view, don't add scroll view. If you go to definition, a scroll view is a type of layout, right? So we don't need scroll view. I just want to mention that when you have a list view, don't add scroll view. Okay. So we have a scroll view, but there's nothing in it. The first thing we need to do is to make scroll view display something. So when we come to the code behind, we can see that we still have the event handlers, but we don't have the buttons anymore. So we can delete the event handlers. So now in order to show something in the list view, right, we need to have an array of something to display, right? So let's say we have a list of strings, and this strings, we call it, let's say contacts, right? And then we are going to have this, and what's going to be inside it is just a list of strings. And let's say there's John Doe. And so we have these names. And then we will need to provide these data to the list. So how do we do that? We need to first of all have a name so that at the code behind we can have a reference the list view. So we have list contacts, right? And then we can say item source. So item source. The type of item source is IEnumerable. So we can put contacts over here. And now let's run the application and see whether there are any changes. Now you can see that we have these contacts nicely displayed in the list view. So this is a very, very basic data binding. When I display this list view in here, you can see there's separators, right? There's separators. And if you click on it, right, basically when an item is selected, there's a default color highlighting which item you selected. Right, so if we go over here and let's format it nicely, different properties in here, more attributes, and then there's a separator, right? There's separated color. There's separator visibility. If you don't like it, you can turn it off. Right? If you want to change the color, for example, I want to change it to, let's say, agua, just for demonstration purpose. I don't like the color, but you see the color has changed, right? And if you don't like the separator at all, then you can use visibility. You can set it to none, and then coming over here, you can see that there's no separator anymore. I do like the default one, which is showing the separator, but maybe we can change it to silver, right? Change it to silver, and then the color becomes silver, which is very similar to the default one. The next thing I want to show you is to actually bind it to a class, right? We can't always have data in a stream because context has like names, phone numbers, maybe emails, maybe addresses. So it's better to use a class to do that. So let's stop debugging and let's create a contact class over here. Later we're gonna separate that contact class in a different class library, which is the correct way to do things. When you go to a company, you will never see people have the class defined in the same file, right? There are two different classes in the defined same file. Sometimes it happens, but most of the time you have your core objects, right? The core classes, the business core classes in a different class library, which we're going to do later. We're going to follow the clean architecture or the clean code approach. Right? For now, for demonstration purpose, I'm going to have a class over here, which is going to be called contact. Right? And then we're going to have just some simple properties. For example, maybe we'll have name, maybe email. Instead of a list of strings, we are going to have a list of contacts. List of contact over here. Change to contact. And then we're going to initialize these contacts. So I have a list of contacts. And now I don't have to change this. And let's run it and see what's going to happen. Okay, so let's build it and run it again. All right, so we have something displayed, but this time, unfortunately, these people are not being displayed, but class names are being displayed, right? The class names along with namespaces being displayed. Why is that? So the default behavior of assigning a list to the item source is that the list view will take each one of these object and run a toString. When you run a toString, whatever it gets, it will be displayed, right? So for example, if I set a breakpoint over here, right, and then I'm gonna stop it and run it again, and let's trigger the breakpoint and you will see what I mean. Okay, so we have these contacts. So let's actually do a quick watch. And then if I do, like, take the first one, which is 0 in the index, we can see that we have the first one, which is John Doe. And then if I do a toString, let's see what is the value. You can see that the value is exactly the one that is being displayed in that list. Right? So this is what I mean. When you just assign the context to the item source, it's going to take each one of those contexts and run a toString. It's going to just display that the result of toString inside the list. So in this case, it's just the namespace plus the class name. So that's not really what we want. Right? Of course, to fix this problem, you can come over here and override the toString method, so that you can display whatever you want. But that's not really the proper way to do it in .NET Maui. A correct way to do it is to use data binding, which means that if we assign this to item source, that is actually okay. But we need to tell the list view what to display and how to display it. And the way to do that is to go to the front end in the XAML file. And then over here, we need to give it a template, right? So because we are trying to tell a list view exactly how to display the item, so we need to specify that in the template. And we can say listView.itemTemplate, right? It's item template because each item in the list is an item, right? That's why it's called item template. And then we have data template. So the data template is basically just the item template. And inside it, we can have a different type of cells. We can have view cell, which is the most flexible approach. There's image cell, right? And there's the basic one is text cell. So we can try to use text cell for now. The text of that is the one that I want to show for now. So what is the text of that? We can say binding. Right. Binding and name. Right. So basically with the curly braces, we are just saying that we are targeting a object, right? So if you have worked with JavaScript before, a curly brace, it refers to an object. So what is the object we're referring to? It is the one that is being bound to the item. So what is being bound to the item? Right? You can see that we have context as the item source. So of course, each item is a one of these contact, right? So this, without specifying the source by default, it refers to the contact object, right? Which is bound to the item. We're specifying an item template. Of course, this is referring to the object that is bound to the item, which is a contact. So that's why in here, this binding just means that we are referring to the object that is being bound to the item. And then here we're just saying, what is the pass? We can say pass equals to the property of that object, which is name. Right, we can see that. You won't get any intelligence over here. It doesn't really know. It's just a string. Right, this is just a string. So it doesn't really know, but you just have to type it directly. So here, the pass is a default property of the binding class. And you can just put name directly over here. Because it's a default property, so you can omit the pass. So you can put name over here. It just tells .NET Maui that we are trying to display the name property of the contact class, right? The context object. So with this change, if we run the application, now you can see that the names are being displayed again, right? Another property of the text cell is called detail. So I'm going to show you what it is. Now, this detail is also a string, but again, you can use binding, right? So we're binding to the property, another property of the context class. And of course, the only other property we have is the email. So we can use email. Now let's see what it looks like. When we come over here, you can see that we have the names and then the detail at the bottom. The names are highlighted, right? It's pretty nice. But if you think that everything is kind of squished together, so we can change the height of the row, right? Or the height of the item. But it's called row height. So, for example, if we say 100, and then let's take a look at what it looks like. Each one of those is pretty tall. So maybe change that to 80. And that looks much better, but it's still too much. Maybe 70. 70 looks much better. Let's say 65. Okay, so now it looks much better. So these are all the things I want to cover for today. We basically cover some basics of list view, right? How to data bind to it, how to adjust the appearance. And in the next few videos, we are going to use list view for our context application. I'll see you in the next one. Do you still remember this map that we mentioned a few videos ago? So in the previous video, when we cover the basics of list view, we covered the view, which is the UI, and the state, which is the data, and also how we map the state to the view, right, which is a basic data binding that we covered in the previous video. In this video, we are going to cover basic events for list view so that we can actually do something with the list view. Let's come to our solution and let's go to the context page. When you have a phone and has a list, you usually use a finger to tap on the item of a list. So there are a couple of events that we are interested in. Right, one of them is called item selected. So let's actually try to handle that event and see what happens. All right, so this generated a new event handler, which automatically showed up here. Let's actually set a breakpoint and run our application and see whether it's triggered or not. Okay, so I'm going to run the application.
Okay, so I'm going to click on one of the items, and you can see that it's triggered this breakpoint. Right, so let's continue. And if I click on the next item, it triggered the breakpoint again. So we're going to continue. But this time, we're going to click on the same item. So I clicked on it, so I'm going to click down a few times. You can see that this breakpoint is not being triggered. So what does that mean? It means that this event handler, item selected, is only triggered when the item selection has changed, right? At the beginning, there's nothing selected. So if you click on any item, the selection changed from nothing to one of the item, right? The item that you clicked on. And then when you click on something else, another item, then of course it's going to trigger the event. But if you click on the same item, it's not going to trigger the event, right? So if you are going to use this event handler to do things, then you have to face this problem. So there are a couple of ways to fix this problem. One of the ways is to deselect the selected item right inside this event. We can just use list contacts dot selected item. So we can set it to now. So basically you do your logic here, right? Your own logic. And then at the end, you can deselect it. Okay, so let's run the application again and to see the behavior. So now if I click on item, well, you can see that the event is triggered, right? And if I run the application again, you now notice that the item is not being selected, right? Because we deselected it again. So this event is going to happen over and over again just because we deselected the item. One thing we can use to test the application is to use the built-in display alert. Right, so we can display a message. So this is going to be, for example, test. And then the message is test. And cancel is, let's just say OK. Right? And we run the application again. Now we don't have the breakpoint, but we have the message. You can see the message. And we click on the OK button. The message disappears. And I can click on the same item and trigger the alert. Let's take a look at another event. Let's go to the XAML file. And another one is called item tapped, right? So let's create a new event handler. And then let's go to the code behind again. You can see a new event handler is generated. So again, let's set some breakpoint. And then let's run the application again to see the behavior, to see whether there are any differences between the two. Okay, so the application runs and we click on the item
You can see the first event is triggered is the item selected. And then if we continue, then the second event is triggered again. Right, so this item tab is triggered afterwards. One of the more reliable way to deselect item is to actually do the deselection inside here, inside the tab event. Right, we're going to do it here. And then you handle your logic inside the item selected. Why is that? Why is that? It's because this item tab event is always happening. Right. Whether you're selecting an item or not selecting an item, whether you tap on the same items or tap on a different item, right? Therefore, this event is triggered way more times than the item selected event, right? So to handle your logic, you don't want to put your logic inside here. If user use their fingers to tap on the item like very, very quickly, this event handler is going to be triggered many, many times, right? Where this one is triggered less. So therefore, we want to do our deselection here and we want to do our logic here because you don't want your logic to run inside here because it's going to run for many, many times, right? So this is a more reliable way to put our deselection over here, and putting our logic inside item selected is better. So to give it a test, make sure that it actually works, we can put our display alert inside here. Right? So we're going to do test and then I'm going to say OK. And we're going to run the application again. So I'm going to click on an item and we see this alert. Click on OK. Click on another one. We see the alert. And you can see that the deselection is happening, right? Nothing is being selected. So this is the exact behavior we are expecting. Here you will notice there is actually a bug. I think it's a bug for item selection, right? For this item selected event. This event is going to be triggered twice if we use we try to deselect, right? So let's take a look at the behavior. I click on this and then we have, actually let's remove the breakpoint. So I click on that already, and then now I click on the OK button. But you see that I clicked on the OK button already, but this alert dialog is not disappearing. I have to click on the OK button again, right? So it appears that I click on the same button again, but it's not the case. It's actually what's actually happening is that this event handler is triggered twice. So let's put the breakpoint back again. Okay. And then let's click on any of the item and run it again. And you see that it happens twice. Right. So now there's actually two dialogues. That's why we need to click on twice. I think the logic here is that this shouldn't be called item selected. It should be called unchanged, right? Item selection changed. What is happening is that first time you click on the item, the item selected changed from null to something. And then because we deselected here, so the item selected is changed from something to null. And that triggers the event again, right? So I think it's a bug, but we always have a workaround. To solve this problem, we can just say if list contacts dot selected is not null. And then we put our logic inside here, right? So our logic should be inside here. We only deal with anything if there is actually a selected item. Right? If there's no selected item, we don't need to do anything. So if we run the application again, now you should see that the alert only triggered once. So let's run the application. Okay, so let's try that. Click on this. We have this alert. Click on OK button. It disappears right away. Right? So our workaround works. So now let's actually put our logic here. So what do we want to do? We want to, when we click on a contact, we want to go to that contact, right? So, which means that we want to go to the edit contact page. So for that, if you remember, our logic is to use shell.current.goToAsync. We can directly call it this way, or we can use await and async, and then we can go to the page. So for that, we're going to say edit contact page. And then later, probably in the next video, we're going to talk about how to pass information when we navigate to another page. Today, we're just going to navigate to the page because we mainly want to focus on the event handling of the list view. Okay, so let's click on any of the item. And we're looking at the edit contact page. Click on cancel button, going back, click on it again, going to edit contact page. Okay, so that's everything I want to cover in this video. I'll see you in the next one. We already have a contacts page. The next step is to create an edit contact page to be able to see the details of the contact and be able to edit the contact. Before we do anything, if we look at the contacts page, we can see that we have the hard-coded list here, right? And then we have the contact class, the core class, that is defined right on this page, the code behind of the page. So that's something we have to fix before we can continue. So I know that I've mentioned eventually we're going to have a clean architecture, but for now, for the purpose of learning .maui, we're not going into the proper architecture right now. We are going to create a folder right in the same project, and we're going to call it models. So we are going to have our contact class defined inside the models folder. Okay, so I'm going to cut this piece of code here, and then I'm going to create a contact class here inside the models folder. I'm just going to call it contact. All right, so this is going to be a public class. And then actually, I'm just going to replace this with this. And to define this class properly, at least we're going to add another property. There's going to be more properties later. But for now, we're going to have a contact ID. Right. So when that is done, when we come back to our contacts page, we can still see we have this list hard-coded here. How do we deal with this? Now, let's look at this way. This is data, right? So I know that we are hard-coding the data, but whether we're dealing with an in-memory data storage or we're dealing with a file to store the data and then later we'll retrieve the data from the file, or we're dealing with a database and we retrieve the data from the database into our application, we need to have a central place to encapsulate data operations, meaning insert data, update data, retrieve data, and delete data. Right? We need to have a central place to encapsulate those operations. We can't let those logics scattered in our application everywhere. For that, we can use repository. Right? A repository is a central place where those operations are encapsulated. Right? It shields our application from doing those operations so that when we replace a repository with another one, then we can deal with data from different sources, right? We can have a repository for in-memory, we can have a repository for file, and we can have a repository for database, right? For in-memories, databases are pretty good for quality assurance, right? To fake some data. From files, we don't use that often. From databases, very good for enterprise level development. For now, we're going to have a simple static repository. And later we're going to create proper repositories, and then we use dependency injection to inject the repository into our application. And to do that, we're just going to create a repository class under the models folder, and we are just going to call it contact repository. And this is going to be a static class. This is a repository which serves the purpose of doing all of those data operations within the memory, right? Of course, later when we use Clean Architecture, we are going to have different repositories to deal with databases, for example. And then we're going to use dependency injection to inject those repositories into our application logic layer. But for now, we are going to only have this to deal with in memory. Now, it's going to be a static class, and then we are going to have a static list. Right? So let's go back and just basically, I'm just going to cut this part. And then we're going to replace this. So we initialize the data with 4 contacts so that at least we have something to see before we add a contact. Right? So we have this. And of course, we need to have a method for get all of the contacts. So we are going to have a list of contact, right? And then we can have get contacts. And this is just going to give us all of the contacts. And this has to be a static method. Perhaps we are going to add another one, right? And this is one single contact. So we're going to say get contact by ID. Right, and then we're going to put in contact ID, and then we are going to say return dash contacts. Should use dash. Well, it doesn't matter. We don't have to use dash, but I'm choosing to use dash in this course. I mean, not dash underscore. So underscore contacts. And then over here, I'm just going to say first or default. We use lambda expression and contact ID equals to contact ID. Here, this contact is from within this namespace, which is this particular contact. Right. So now we have get contacts. We have get contact by ID. And I think those methods are good enough for now. Let's go back to our class. Here we have the contacts. So we are just going to use our contact repository inside this class, and then we're going to say get contacts. And if we run the application again, we should have everything that we have seen before. Now, you can see that it complains about a contact inside the contact contacts page. It says contact is an ambiguous reference between our own contact, and there is actually a contact inside the communication namespace. So in order to refer to our contact, we're going to use something like this. I'm going to say using tang contact equals contacts.maui.models.contact. So this, right, tells our code that when we refer to contact inside this file, we're referring to our own contact instead of the contact under the communication namespace. Okay, so let's try to run the application again. Now you can see that all of the contacts are listed in the list view. That means our static repository is working for us. So now we are ready to go to the next step, which is to create the edit contact page. Currently, we do have an edit contact page. If we click on it, we go to the edit contact page, but there's nothing in it, right? We need to view the details information on the contact page, first of all, right? And then we can deal with the update. But in order to see the contact information on the edit contact page, we need to know which one we're looking at, right? Which contact we're looking at. Or basically, we're saying that we need to know which contact the user clicked on in the contact list page, right? So to know that, we will need to pass information from the contacts page to the edit contact page. And how do we do that? So if we look at our contacts page, when the user clicked on a contact item, we are using URL-based navigation to navigate to the edit contact page. And if you have done any web application development, or if you just go online, you have seen those patterns that in the URL, we have a question mark, and then there's an equal sign, and afterwards, there's some strings after that. So that is called a query string. Right? So here, because we have the URL-based navigation in .NET MAUI, it actually borrows the same concept. So we can pass those information from a page to another page when we use URL-based navigation in .NET MAUI. So let's see how we do that here. Here we can pass different things, not only just strings, but for simplicity, we're going to learn with strings first, right? So basically here, we are just going to say something like, you know, which page are we going to, right? And then we can use a question mark and say, you know, contact ID equals to whatever. And then on the added contact page, we can receive this contact ID. So in order to do that, we are going to, let's roll back. You can see we were using name of, but let's use string interpolation here, right? With curly braces. And then here we can just say, let's use ID. So just for simplicity, right? ID, and what is the ID? It's the selected item. It's list contacts dot selected item. And then this selected item is a object, but we can cast that into a contact object, right? So let's do that. Once we cast it into contact object, then we can know the contact ID. So here, this is the query string parameter, and this is the value, right? We can receive that information on this page, which is the added contact page. So let's go to added contact page. So this is the code behind of the added contact page. Here in the added contact page, in order to receive the parameter value that it passed from the context page, we would need to have a property, and that property should correspond to that parameter value. Right? In this case, we're receiving a contact ID, so it's a property, and we only need to have a setter. So this setter will be triggered when the information is passed over to the added contact page. Right? So then how do we know that this is the property that should be triggered, right? This is the setter of the property that should be triggered. On the class, we can use property, and we're going to say query property, right? Query property. And the query property has two parameters. The first parameter, well, let's talk about the second parameter. The second parameter is actually the query ID. And what is the query ID? It's basically this parameter, this, the name of this parameter. So in here, it's just called ID, which is the second one. I'm typing the second one, right? And what is the first one? The first one is the name of the property. Right? So here we can say name of contact ID. Right, so name of the property. So basically this query, let's stop this. Right. So basically this query property is telling us that whenever we receive the parameter value from the previous page, right, which is the context page, we will map that parameter value to this property. Right? And this property is right here. And then when that happens, the setter will be set, and the value of that property is within the value, right? Within the value, you know, in the setter we can call value, right? It's within here. So now we actually have the value of the contact ID right inside the setter. What should we do here? We need to call the contact repository, right? Dot get contact by ID, which we just created, right? And here we have the value that we need to pass in. And of course, we can use, you know, int parse that into an integer. If the value is inappropriate, that means we need to throw exception. We should let that exception throw because that's a coding error, right? So we get the contact, and then we can store that contact in a private variable here. And this private variable, we can define it inside the code behind class. And it's going to be of course, contact and contact. That's it. So here, which contact class are we referring to? We can use the same. Remember, we are using the same approach that we used last time. So we need to specify that we are referring to our own contact class that we define in the model's namespace in .contact. And in the setter, we basically set the contact. So now we have the contact. In order to prove that we actually received contact, let's go to the front end of the edit contact page and we see a label. So let's give this label a name, right? And so call it LBL, just a name. And then once we receive the contact, we're going to assign that contact, right, to the label so that we can actually see it. And let's run the application and let's see whether we can see the contact name or not.
Okay, so let's click on Tom Hanks. And for whatever reason, we're seeing John Doe. And that's pretty weird. I don't know what's happening. So let's actually debug. Let's go to the contact. First, let's go to the contacts page. Right, and let's see whether the selected item is actually correct. Let's actually go back. And then I'm clicking on Tom Hanks. So the selected item, let's check what it is. It's ID 0. Of course, it's ID 0 because we didn't actually provide ID. That's my fault. Let's go back to contact repository. I didn't provide ID, so everything is 0. So that's why it's John Doe,
because John Doe is the first item. So let's give the ID over here. Provide the ID for each one of those items. Of course, we need to change them to 1, 2, 3, 4, and let's run the application again.
Okay, let's try myself. Let's remove the breakpoint. I think it's gonna work. Okay, so I can see my name. Go back, Tom Hanks. I thought I removed the breakpoint, but anyways, I've typed Tom Hanks, so that's correct. Let's try one more, which is John Doe. So I have John Doe. So everything looks correct. So in this lesson, first we learned about creating a static repository. This is mainly for teaching purpose. Creating a static repository for you is mainly for, let's say you're creating a mockup, right? Or you're faking the repository. So this static repository will provide you with a convenient way, a quick way to mock the data, right? And then later you can use clean architecture, the plugin based clean architecture, to plug in a different repository, right? So, or you can use the static repository to provide you the fake data for testing purpose. Let's say you're in the QA team and then you want to use a different data than the real data, then you can create a simple static repository to provide the data. But anyhow, I don't prefer the static repository. Like I said, the static repository is mainly for teaching so that we can quickly have data and we can still use the concept of repository to encapsulate all of the data operations within a central place so that we don't have all of the data operations scattered everywhere in our application, right? I wanted it to be encapsulated in a central place. So we learned about this concept. We created a static repository, and then we learned about passing information from one place to another, right? One page to another. Here, we're passing through the query parameter, right? And then this is the value. And then inside the place where we receive the information, right? We first create a write-only, right? A write-only or set-only property to receive that. And of course, the type of that should be the type of the parameter that is passed in from the other page, right? And then over here, we use a attribute, right? And this is the query property attribute. The first parameter is the name of the property, and the second one is the name of the parameter, right? The query string parameter, right? And then you're going to receive this. And that's everything I want to cover in this video. I'll see you in the next one.
In the next couple of videos, we are going to work on the edit contact page. And for that, we need to familiarize ourselves with stack layout. Right, currently, if we go to the edit contact page, we can see that there's the vertical stack layout. Actually, there's a stack layout, and the orientation can be either vertical or horizontal. In .NET MAUI, there's actually, for convenience purpose, there's a vertical stack layout and a horizontal stack layout. The default orientation of a stack layout is a vertical stack layout. Okay, so if we do it this way, then it would be the same as the vertical stack layout before we change it. Right, so if we let it run and then we use hot reload to see what's happening when we make changes, then we can see that they are the same. Okay, the application is running. Let's click on one of the contact to go to the edit contact page. Right now we have the stack layout and it looks exactly the same as the vertical stack layout, right? Because the default orientation is vertical. Okay, let's learn about several things about a stack layout. First, we have this orientation, which I mentioned. So let's actually put it on the left side and then our application on the right hand side. So I'm going to put it over here and then I'm going to drag this over to here. And then let me minimize Solution Explorer. So let me actually comment out. Actually, let's comment out the whole thing, okay, to make it clearer. Comment out the whole thing, and then let's go to the code behind, and let's comment out this, and we don't have the cancel button, so let's comment out this. All right, so let's just focus on how stack layout works for now. All right, so let's add a empty stack layout. All right, so what we need to know is, first of all, we need to know some important properties of stack layout. So let's put something. Let's put box view, right? Box view is basically a view that looks like a box. So it's very good for placeholders and very good for us to understand how layout works. We can specify the color of a box view so that we can see the size of the size and position of the box view, right? So if we just do it this way, you can see that there's nothing on it, right? That's because we didn't specify the size. So let's specify the size, and we can use box view to understand how the views in stack layout positioned, how the size and position worked. We're gonna add another one, and we're gonna make this one, let's say it's gonna be blue. Right, and another one maybe red, and another one maybe yellow. Right, so if I save it, you can see there are different things. So this tells us that in the stack layout, each one of the child views are stacked together, right, up and down, because the orientation is vertical, right? Because the default orientation is vertical, so each one of the child views are stacked together, right? So agua is the top one, and then blue, red, and yellow. So you can see agua, blue, red, yellow. So if we change the stack layout to horizontal stack layout, and then if I save it, now we see nothing. Why is that? Well, to answer that question, let's change the height request to width request. And then click on the save button. You can see that everything is showing up. And agua is on the left. Obviously, everything's stacked together again, but it's stacked from left to the right, right? The vertical layout stacks views top to bottom, and horizontal stack layout stack views from left to right, right? And there's an important property that we need to understand, which is the spacing, right? Now you can see that each one of the box views are connected together, right? So if we specify a spacing here, then you can see that there's a space in between, right? So if we change this back to vertical, then of course we have to change this to height. Then you can also see the gaps. Another thing that is very important is for a vertical layout, a control like a box view, a button for example, by default, fills the entire screen from left to right, right? And if it's a horizontal stack layout, by default, the box view or buttons, those controls or views will fill the screen from top to bottom, right? That's the default behavior.
But you can modify that by specifying the width request. So let's say the width is 100, right? So if I do that, notice that the agua box view is changed, right? And this is only 100 from left to right, right? That's the width, right? So if I specify all of them, right, they look like that. Then the question comes, like, how do we configure the position of the box view? It's always in the middle. There is horizontal options, right? And by default, the horizontal option for a box view or a button is center. But if we specify start, then now you can see the box view move to the left. And we specify this as the center, and then specify this as right, sorry, end. Then you can see that center is center, start is left, end is right, right? And default, the yellow one, stays as default. Default is also center.
So for a vertical stack layout, you cannot position child views vertically because they just stack on top of each other. Well, there's nothing to control, right? But you can configure the height. Whereas for a vertical stack layout, you are able to configure the horizontal positionings, right? And you have three options: start, center, and end. Now, when it comes to a horizontal stack layout, okay, so let's comment out this, make a copy, and then comment out this. And then let's change this vertical stack layout to horizontal stack layout. Of course, now the width and height kind of flips. So we're going to change this to 100 and width to 50. Otherwise, it will look very, very weird because we don't have enough space from left to right. Now you can see that everything is in the middle. The horizontal options is not going to work because for a horizontal stack layout, we can only control the positioning of the child views on the vertical level, right? On the opposite level. So what we can do is we can specify the vertical options. For vertical options, then we can specify start, center, and end. So when we do that, you can see the start goes to the top, right? Because that's the agua. And then blue is in the center and red is at the bottom. By default, we don't specify anything, it stayed at the center, right? So now you can see that for a horizontal layout, you can specify the position vertically. Whereas for a vertical layout, you can specify the position horizontally, right? Using the horizontal options. Whereas when it's a horizontal layout, you can use vertical options, right? So that's the takeaway. And other than that, the spacing is very, very important. Of course, again, for vertical stack layout, you use the height request to specify the size, and then you use the width request to specify the size for a horizontal stack layout. Now, let's comment out the horizontal stack layout, and then we'll go back and use the vertical stack layout. Well, let's add a label, actually, because label behaves differently from box view or a button. So we're going to say text test label. Now, you can see that it appears at this position. So what is this position? This is horizontal position, and that's the start horizontal position, right? So if we were to say horizontal options start, and it's not going to change anything, right? So let's also add a background color to say this is, let's say, gray. And now you can see that the label, it's not like if we don't specify the width request of the box view, the whole thing is going to fill the entire screen, right, on the width. Whereas for a label, it does not fill the entire width. But we can use the horizontal options to say fill. And when we do that, you can see that the entire width is occupied by the label, right? Because the background actually tells us how big it is. And again, we can use the horizontal options to specify where the text is positioned. Now you can see that they are positioned differently according to start, center, and end, right? So left, middle, and right. Another thing you also want to understand is that layout, not only a stack layout, all of the layout can be nested, right? So for example, if we put another horizontal stack layout inside the vertical stack layout. So this is going to appear at the bottom because it's a stack layout, right? It's a vertical stack layout. And then we are going to put a label and we're going to say text equals name, right? And then we are going to say entry, right? So this entry is basically an input field, right? Entry over here. And now if I save it, what does it look like? Well, you can see that there's entry field here. You can see the keyboard is showing up. So this is a entry. But you can actually notice that there is a kind of a misalignment. Remember that for horizontal stack layout, we can actually use vertical options to specify the alignment vertically, right? So let's actually use vertical options here. Let's say center. Right, so that we can align them together, vertical options and then center. So I'm going to save. Now you can see that they are aligned together beautifully, right? So let me remove these words, right? And if we even put words here, you can see that words is aligned with the label name. So everything looks perfect. And then of course, if you want to add a spacing between the label and the entry view, then you can use spacing over here. And let's say we put 5 there, then added a space here nicely, right? A gap. Okay. That's everything we want to mention about stack layouts, right? Whether it's vertical or horizontal. Let's go ahead and actually work on this page. But remember that we only have two views, two meaningful views, right? A name and email. Maybe let's add a phone number, right? And perhaps also a address. Let's actually stop this. So we have a few other views, and then we can come over here to our contact page and let's delete these experimental layouts here and let us add the actual views. So here I want to use a horizontal stack layout to add the child views, right? So we are going to have a label just like what we did just now. And then this is going to be the name of the person. Right. And then we are going to have a entry field for it. For now, there's no data binding yet. And of course, we're going to add vertical options center and then another vertical options center over here. Now we're going to copy this and we're going to repeat this a few times. All right. Because the first one is for name. The second one, let's for email. Second one, the third one is for phone number. And maybe the last one is the address. Okay. Now you can see we have our name, email, phone number, and address, right? Things are not actually aligned properly. So for vertical layout, we want to add a margin and we are going to say 10, 0, 0, 0. Then when we do that, you can see that the left changed. So this is the margin left. This is the margin top. So let's say I'm going to put 10 on the top as well. then you can see that it actually moved down a little bit, right? So maybe the margin 10 is not enough. So let's specify 20, right? So that's better. And then you can see that the entry fields are not aligned to the left. So then how do we fix that problem? We can specify the width request for each one of the labels. Right. Let's say each one of them is 80. And then you can see that they are aligned together, but it seems that 80 is too much. So maybe let's say 60. Now that looks much better. But if you want to make it a little bit better, we can add a frame around the horizontal layout. Right. So when we do that, you can see the name field becomes like this. So why this side, the right-hand side, is sticking to the border? That's because we didn't add a margin here. So this is, remember, this is left and this is top and this is right. So we need to add the same margin as the left margin. So the right margin now becomes 20. And now you can see that the frame basically provides a border and it has a radius. So that looks pretty good, but then it's too big, right? It's too big. So, but we can specify the padding, right? The padding is the inner side. Right, margin is the outside and the padding is inside. If we specify 0 to all of them, then it becomes like this. It doesn't look really good. So let's specify the left hand side to be 10 and the right hand side to be 10 as well. Then now it looks pretty good. So maybe we can add top padding to be 2 and bottom to be 2 and make it look a little bit better, right? So now we can put frame on each one of those horizontal layout. And now we have all of the views beautifully displayed on the screen. Perhaps I want to see a bigger gap on the top. So maybe 20 as the top margin. So now everything looks much better. So that's what I want to cover for this video. And I'll see you in the next one. In this video, we're going to continue working on the edit connect page. Right. So we had these views displayed, but one of the things that the edit contact page needs to do is to display the contact information. So we're going to work on that first in this video. Let's review. We added the phone and address views in the contact class. So now we go to the contact repository. Maybe we should, initialize them. Maybe we don't have to, right? We don't have to initialize them. So let's review that we do have this getContactById method already. So this will help us to pull the information, right? And then let's go to the edit contact page and let's review that we already have this parameter that is passed in, right? And this property receive the ID parameter from the URL and that retrieve the contact object from our repository. And here we're supposed to assign the information of the contact to our views. Right here we have these entries. Later we're going to use data binding, but for now we're just going to use name. Right, we're using the event driven approach first and then followed by MVVM. So now we're going to use names to reference. So here, this is entry name, and this one would be entry email, phone number, last but not least, address. Okay, so let's go to the code behind and let's assign those values over here. So entry name dot text equal to, well, first of all, this get contact by ID method may return nothing, right? If the ID is incorrect. That shouldn't happen, but just to be safe, we are going to say if contact is not null, then we are going to assign values to these views, right? So this is name, and then we have entry.address text equals contact.address email phone. All right, so we have all four views in here. While we are here, we're going to put this cancel button back. All right, so let's go to the front end, also put our cancel button
at the bottom. Okay, and let's delete the original stack layout. Let's put it over here at the bottom. And let's run the application to see whether we can see the information of the contact.
All right. Okay, it's running. So let's go to one of the contact. Now you can see it's pulling the information in. We can see the name. We can see the email. We don't have the phone number and we don't have the address. Let's click on the cancel button to make sure that we can go back to our contacts page. All right. Let's go to another one. Make sure it's pulling the correct information all the time. Right. All right. It's doing pretty good. We're going to try all of our contacts. And this time it's Jane Doe. So that's pretty good. Now we should work on our updates. For that, let's go to our repository first.
And let's create a update method. Again, it's going to be a static method. And it's going to be a void function. And I'm going to call it update contact. And first of all, we're going to have the ID to specify which contact we want to update. And then we're going to pass in the information that contains the information that needs to be used to update existing records, right? So first of all, we will need to make sure that the ID that is passed in is the same as the ID is in the contact object, right? So if they're not the same, I'm just going to return, right? And at this point, they're the same. So because we're using an in-memory database,
so we may encounter a problem here, but we will try to fix that problem when we encounter that. For now, let's just code normally, right? So what are we going to do? We are going to use the getContactById, right? First of all, we're going to get our target contact to be updated, right? So contact to update equals get contact by ID, and we just provide the ID here. And we need to make sure that the contact is in the data store, right? So if it's not now, then we start updating. Eventually, when we use a database, for example, we're not going to do this, but for now, we will need to update the fields manually. Of course, we're not going to update the ID, but we are going to update all of the other fields. So we have email, name, and phone number. If you want to use AutoMapper, for example, you can use that, but I think we don't have a lot of fields, so I'm just manually populating them. Again, if you're interested, you can check out AutoMapper, right? But I'm not going to use AutoMapper in this course. So now we have the update contact method, right? And let's go back to our front end, and we need to add a button. And that button is going to be the contact button, right? Do we have a spacing here? We do have 10 spacing, so that's pretty good. We don't have to adjust positioning. So this is going to be called BTN update. And of course, the text is going to be update. And we're going to generate a new event handler here by doing this, right? And let's just right click on it and then go to field. And then we can see we have our new method here. So this is the event handler, and here we can use the contact repository to do the update, right? We have the update method already. Remember, we are not using data binding. So we will need to get information from each one of these fields, right? So what should we do? We can say contact. Remember, we have a contact already, right? Defined over here, and it's populated with the contact ID method, the setter, the contact ID property, right? With the setter here. So we can say that contact.name equals entry name.text, contact.address equals entry address.text. So one of the reasons to use MVVM is to eliminate the process of manually populating the fields, right? That's one of the reasons. Imagine you have a lot of views and you have to do this many, many times. That's definitely a pain. Okay, so I have all of the views populated. Now I can say contact.contactID, right? And then here I'm just passing in the contact object. Okay, so after I update the contact, what do I do? Of course, I'm going to just navigate back to the previous page, which is the contacts page. So that's the same effect of clicking on the cancel button. Okay, so let's give it a try and see whether it works or not. All right, so let's go to any of the contact. And let's, for example, add a phone number. Just putting a random number here. And then I'm going to click on the update button. But before I do that, let's go to the contact repository and then let's set a breakpoint here. Right? I'm expecting a problem, but let's see whether we have that problem or not. Okay, so I have the contact ID 4, which is correct. Right? And then I have the phone number in here. But let's take a look at this contacts object. And let's find the last one, which is number 4, right? And you can see that there is already a phone number. You don't even need to update. Why is that? Like I mentioned just now, this is a in-memory data store. And when we call the getContactById, we're returning the object inside this list. So basically, this reference is returned back. So therefore, when we are in the added contact page, when we handle the update event, we already updated that object in the list directly. Then we don't even need to do the update here because it's already updated. So that is incorrect because in the actual data store, we don't return a reference of the object in the server, right? So for example, if there's a SQL server, there is an instance of the server that is running. That's true, but we don't return that. We return a copy of that value, right? So therefore, we will have to stop debugging and we have to fix the problem. So how do we fix that problem? We have to return a copy here. So this is the contact that we found, right? And we are going to say if contact is not now, then we're going to make a copy, right? We're going to make a copy of the contact. If the contact is now, then of course we're just returning now here. Okay. And also, most importantly, the contact ID has to be populated as well. Okay, so we fixed this problem here, but remember that we actually use the getContactById method down in here, and then we are updating this contact to update. But however, because we created a copy of the contact, so we cannot use the getContactById anymore because this is a copy. Our intention is to actually update the object in the list, right? In which list? In this list. So what we can do is we can actually just copy this, right? We use lambda expression to actually find the contact to update. So we change this variable to contact to update and change this variable to contact to update. And then we close our if statement and then we put our logic inside this particular if statement. Okay. So you can see that we directly looks for the contact object whose ID is the same as the ID that is passed in. And then if we can find the contact to update object, then we update it. So this time it should fix our problem. And then let's run the application again. Okay, let's choose one of them. For example, if I choose myself, and then let's actually make a change in the email as well. So I'm going to put a dot between Frank and Liu. So instead of Frank Liu, it becomes Frank.Liu. And then I'm just going to put a random phone number here. If I click on the update button, it's going to take me to the contact list, right? Let's set up breakpoints. Do set up breakpoint and make sure that everything is updated properly, right? So let's go over here. We have the contact ID that is passed in, and we are able to find the contact to update. And then we are updating them, updating the information. So let's actually look into our verb list, and let's see that you see that the email is updated and the phone number is populated. All right, so let's continue. And remember that we provided, we changed our email address. We added a dot in here. So let's continue and watch. Right, now you can see that this Frank Liu email address did not change. Right, but watch carefully. If I click on this contact list item again, going back over here, you can see that the dot is here. Right, the dot is here. Click on the cancel button, go back, dot is gone. So that's a problem, and we are going to work on fixing that problem in the next video. In the previous video, we're having problems of updating the contacts page. So let's go to contacts page and see what's happening. So we have this constructor here where we actually use the contact repository in the constructor, and we get the contacts, and we assign the contacts to the item source. So you may be thinking that this is the reason, because the contacts page, once it's activated, once it's created, it lives there in the memory. And when we are back, like when we navigate back from the edit contact page to the contacts page, this will not be executed. So if we can find a place to activate, to call this two lines of code again, we might be able to solve this problem. So let's actually do that. Okay, so I'm cutting those two lines, and we're trying to override one of the event in the event cycle, which is on appearing. Okay, so this on appearing is going to be called every time the page regains the focus. Okay, for example, if another page is on top, and then when we navigate back to this page, then the on appearing will be called. Of course, when the page is just created, the first time it appears, the on appearing is going to be called. It seems to be the perfect place to call these two lines of code. And let's actually try that. Okay, let's run the application. Okay, I'm going to go to Tom Hanks, and I'm gonna make a change. Right, add a dot again, and then I don't know his phone number. I'm just gonna use Toronto's phone number, for example, random phone number. Clicking on the update button. I'm gonna remove this breakpoint, continue, and you can see we're still having the same problem. Right, still having the same problem. If we click on it again, you can see it is actually already updated, Tom.hanks, right? And we have the phone number. But going back, it's not showing. Okay, so what is actually happening? What is actually happening? You may be thinking, oh, maybe the on appearing is not being called when we go back. Let's set a breakpoint and see what's actually happening there. So on appearing, I'm going to set a breakpoint here. Right, so let's click on this Tom Hanks. Go to Tom Hanks and then come back. Whether we click on cancel or update, it's going to navigate back. You can see that is actually being called, right? It's being called. And if we look at the contacts, I think that's number 3, right? You can see that it's actually have the correct data with the phone number. But the problem is with this line. So it looks like this line is not working. And then that's true. It's actually not working. So let's go to the diagram. Let's draw something so that hopefully I can make you understand what is actually happening. So for example, we have a page here. So this is a page. And then this page actually displays some data, right? So let's make it vertical, so it looks like a cell phone, right? And then we have some data that is loaded in the memory. So I'm using a circle to represent that the data is loaded in the memory, right? But remember that we have a a view in here. In this case, we have a list view. And when the list view is populated with the data, the list view stores a copy of that data in a different format, of course. And in the memory, we have another copy of that data, which is in the contact repository. These two copies are not the same copy. So in .NET MAUI, if you don't notify the list view or any view, there's a change in the data. The data in the list view or any other views will not actually update. Right? You have to actually tell it to notify the view that there is a change in the data, and then the view will do the update. So that's more or less like a unique thing that you have to do in .NET MAUI. If you came from a web application background, you may be thinking that's pretty weird, right? But this is what's happening in .NET MAUI. You have to notify it. And the way to notify it is to use observable data. So it's like observe pattern, where you have the data here and then you have the subscribers. So you have subscriber 1, subscriber 2, you know, you have different number of subscribers. Let's say we only have 2. And then the subscriber is actually subscribing to the observable data. And when the observable data changes, it's going to actually send a notification. And because both subscriber 1 and subscriber 2 subscribe to the observable data, then it actually receives that notification, and then the subscriber can do whatever it wants. Right? So in .NET MAUI, this is already built in, right? In the views. So in our case, we have the list view in here, and this list view is actually when you bind the data to the list view tries to subscribe. But because you can see that we are not using observable data, so this is just a list of contacts, right? It's a regular list. So that's why it's not actually working, because a regular list cannot send notification to the .NET MAUI views, right? In this case, it's list view. So how do we solve this problem? Let's go back to our code. And then in here, let's remove the breakpoint. Instead of just call the repository get contacts, we can use observable collection. Right, so new observable collection. You gotta do control dot to import namespace. It's from system.collections.objectModel. So when we do that, and we can provide the type of the element, and then in here, we can call the repository to provide the data. And of course, here, this is going to be a observable. So we can use var. And now let's rebuild the application and redeploy to our emulator. Our application is running. Let's click on one of the contact. And let's make the same change. I'm going to add a dash here. And then whatever the phone number is, doesn't matter. We're going to work on the validation later. So clicking on update, go back over here. You can see that tom-hanks@gmail.com is being displayed. So that solves our problem, right? Because we are using observable collection, so when the observable collection changes, it actually notify the list view. So the list view then is able to update itself with the new data. Otherwise, it's just keep the data in the memory without updating, which actually saves resources, right? So that's what I want to cover in this video, and I'll see you in the next one. In the previous videos, we have added these views in the edit contact page. In this video, we are going to work on validations. Right. For example, the name should be required. Email address should be a valid email address. To do that, we are going to go to the solution, and then we click on Manage NuGet Package. Let's search community Community Toolkit. And when we do that, we can see we have this Community Toolkit.Maui. And let's just select our project and click on Install. And I accept. So the toolkit is installed as a NuGet package, right? But then here, it's reminding us that we need to add this line to our MauiProgram.cs. So let's go over here, and then let's add this line here. And then this actually resolved the problem. We have this using community toolkit.maui. This is automatically added for us. So we just added this line, which is indicated in the README file. So we initialized our toolkit in there, right? So this is for initializing the toolkit. Let's close the README file. Coming back to the added contact page. So how do we use the toolkit? In the toolkit, they're different. Of course, there are different things. The ones that we're interested in are the validation behaviors. So for example, the name should be a required field, right? Meaning that it cannot be empty. So for that, we can come over here under the entry, like within the entry, we can say entry.behaviors, right? So this is part of the community toolkit that we just installed. And then we can then use toolkit. This namespace does not exist, right? So we can create that namespace here, just like we created this extension namespace. So we need to do XML namespace colon toolkit. You don't have to call it toolkit. You can call it whatever you want. But here we need to refer to the toolkit, right? The Maui toolkit that we just added. And then here we can use toolkit colon. And you can see there's different behaviors, right? There's even the animation behavior you can use for animation, but today we're going to cover some of the validation behaviors. Right, first of all, for required field, we can use the text behavior, which is at the bottom, right? Text behavior. And then you can close it. Don't have to close it this like this. We can close it just like this. There's several properties in here. To make this text validation behavior work like a required field validation behavior, we can just set the minimum length to be 1, right? So at least there has to be 1 character, right? Another important property here is the flags. So this configures the behavior of this text validation. So do we validate on attaching? Do we validate on focusing of the entry field? Or do we validate on value change? I would suggest to validate on a combination of both attaching, right? So you can do a comma and then validate on value change. So this guarantees that in any scenario, it's going to work. For example, let's say this is a add contact page. So when you come to the add contact page, all of the fields are empty. So you're looking at the name field. And if you don't even touch it, if you only specify the validate on value change flag here, then when you click on the add button or submit button, it's not even going to trigger the validation because you didn't even change anything. You didn't even touch the field. So the field is not dirty. It's not going to actually trigger the validation at all. That's why we also need the validate on attaching. That means that when the validation behavior is attached to the entry field, it does the validation already, right? Which it will see that the field is empty, and then it will know that it's invalid. So we need a combination of this, right? And then in order to reference the validation field, we need to give it a name. So we can call it name validator. Another important property I want to mention, but I'm not going to use today, is the regular expression pattern property. Right, so you can use this to limit the format of the text in the entry field. So let's delete this. Okay. So we're saying that name is a required field. Right, so then how do we spit out the error message? So for that, we can go to the code behind. So let's go to the code behind. And just before everything in the update clicked event handler, we can then say if name validator is valid, it is valid or is not valid. So if it's not valid, then we're going to just return, right? But before we return, we can spit out the error message by saying display alert. And then the title is error. The message is name is required. Right? And then you say okay. So this will help us to validate the name. So let's give it a try. Okay, the application is running. And let's go to one of the contact. And of course, you know, we only apply the validator on the name field. And there is a value in here. So it definitely is valid. So let's actually give it a try. Click on update. Nothing's happening. It's valid. So let's go back. And then let's try to delete these field. Delete the name field. And click on the update. Now the error is showing. It's complaining that name is required. So now let's go back. And let's put some name over here. Let's just say whatever name. And then click on the update button again. Now it's updated. We can see the updated name over here. And then let's go back and fix the name. Okay, that's a simple validation. So let's add another one, which is for email validation. So let's go to email. So when we look at the email address, of course, we may think we need multiple validation behaviors because the email address may be required, right? For a contact application, maybe email address is not actually required, but for demonstration purpose, I want to make it a little bit complex than name, right? Let's say that email address is required. And of course, email address format has to be correct email address format, right? So for that, we actually have a thing in the toolkit that is called multi-validation behavior. So let's use that. Right, because that one, within the multi-validation behavior, you can combine different validation behaviors. So in here, again, we're going to say entry.behaviors, right? And then within that, we're going to have toolkit, and then we're going to have a multi-validation behavior, okay? And of course, we are going to give it a name. We need to reference that. And we're going to call it email validator. And the flags will be the same. So let's copy these two. And then within the multi-validation behavior, we can have multiple validation behaviors. So the first one would be the text validation. Right. So let's copy the previous text validation behavior over here. And then let's remove the name because we don't need a name for this. Right, so this validation behavior provides us the required field validation. Right. Secondly, we will need the email validation behavior and our same flags. Inside multi-validation behavior, there's a way to provide error messages. Right. So to do that, we're going to say toolkit.multi-validation-behavior.error-message. Right. And then here, in the text validation behavior, we can just say email is required, right? And then let's copy this over to the email validation. And the message would be different. Email format is invalid. And now we're ready to go back to our code behind to trigger the validation for the multi-validation behavior. And for that, we are just going to use the same way. We're going to say email validator. If it's invalid, then of course, going to return first. And then before that, we are going to loop through the error messages of the multi-validation behavior. Right, so for each error in email validator dot errors. You see, it's a list of objects, but it's actually a list of string. So for that, we can just display the alert. We can display multiple alert. or you can combine them together in a string builder, for example, and just display everything in one display alert, right, in one alert. But to simplify this, I'm just going to show all of them one by one. So error, and then we can say toString. So this is the message, and then the cancel button is okay. All right, so let's give it a try.
Okay, let's go to one of them. Okay, so of course, I have a valid email address already.
So let's test this. Let's delete the field and then click on the update button. It says the email format is invalid. And then it also says email is required. Right, so it spit out all of the error messages that we are expecting. So let's say I'm going to put an invalid email address, ABC. So click on the update. Now I see email format is invalid. Click on OK. You can see that the required field validation is not triggered anymore. So I can just provide a email address, click on update button. Going back, you can see that my email address is changed. Validation behavior is not triggered. So everything works correctly. So this is what I want to show in this video. I'll see you in the next one. So we have created the added contact page. We have done the field validations. So there's a lot of work. If we are going to create an add contact page, the two pages look very, very similar, right? The functionalities are different. One of add a page is to update the contact. The add page is to add a new contact. So because of the similarities, we need to think about create a reusable control so that we can share that control between these two pages. So today in this video, we are going to work on creating a reusable control. Okay, let's go to the views folder and let's right click and create a new folder. And let's call it controls. And to create a reusable control, we are going to create a new item and we're going to search content view. Okay, and then we're going to select the XAML version. And we can call it just contact control, right? Within the contact control, we can see there are some placeholders. And this is content view. This is not content page anymore. So what we can do is that we can go to edit contact page, and then we can basically select everything and cut it over. Okay, let's cut it over to the contact control here, right? Replace this vertical layout. Okay, and you can see that we only have one problem, which is this toolkit. Namespace problem. So for that, we can just fix that very easily and call it toolkit, just like before, referring to this toolkit. Now you can see that we don't have any problems in here. Now let's look at this contact control. What do we have here? We have these fields, the name, email, right, phone, and address. And these fields needs to be shared out. Right. Currently, it's within the entry email and entry name, all of these entry fields. Right. So we will need to share that out through a property. So let's create the first property, which is going to be the name. And we just can call it name, right? Because this is a contact control. Name refers to the name of the contact. Of course, here we cannot use a regular empty getters and setters. So for getter, we will just return the entry name dot text, right? And as you guessed, the setter will just set the entry name dot text equals to the value, right? And I'll do that the rest, and then I'll come back. Okay, so I've created all of them. I have email, address, and phone number. For sharing properties, values, we're good. Now we go back to the front end. We can see we have taken care of these properties. What about the buttons down below, right? We have an update button. We have a cancel button. I think we should change the name from update to save, right? And then here it's called save, just so that it can be reused in both add and edit page. Right? And here we are going to create a new event handler. And for this one as well, create a new event handler. Going back to the code behind, and we have these two event handler. Here we don't need to take care of the routing, right? The navigation, but we do need to validate, right? So let's go back to the edit contact page and let's think about how we can implement the validation. Here we can just cut this code and go back to the contact control, and then we can do our validation inside here. But the problem is that display alert is not available. Display alert is only available in a page, right? It's basically a content page. So actually let's go back to our edit contact page. If I do a control Z to undo the change, and then if I right click, if I actually hover my mouse over it, you can see it's the display alert is from page, right? And our content page is a page, but the content view is not a page. So display alert is not available here, but that's fine. That's fine. We are going to delete it, both of them. But here we will need to spit out the error. So how do we spit out error? We need to create a event. It's like a delegate in C#. So here we can create an event. It's going to be an event handler. And then the parameter is going to be a string, which will be the error message itself. And then the event itself is going to be called onError. Okay. So we can then scroll down to the bottom. And then here, if we encounter a problem, right, then we will need to spit out that error message. We're going to say onError. Right. And we need to use a question mark. So basically, if the event handler is registered, right, from outside, then we're going to invoke the event. Otherwise, we don't. Right? That's the purpose of this question mark here. I'm going to type dot and then invoke. Right? And then who is the sender? So we can just pass the sender from the event, the click event. And then what is the error message? So that would be the same error message that we had before. I wish I didn't delete them. I just comment them out so that I don't have to type this. But its name is required, right? And then I'm going to copy this and put it over here. The only difference here is that the error message is different. So it's going to be error.toString. And that's it. Right? That's it. But how does the parent control knows that the save button is actually clicked on? Right? For that, we actually need to create another event. And type is event handler. This time we can just use event arguments, and this is on save, right? And since we are here, we're going to also react to the cancel button click, right? So then here, when everything is validated, then we can tell our parent page, whichever page that uses this control, that the user clicked on the save button, it's actually validated already, right? So whenever this event on save is triggered, is invoked, we have already validated, right? So here we can just invoke, and then we use the sender and also the event arguments from the clicked event, right? And then of course on cancel, we can just say on cancel, and then we invoke that event with the sender and the event arguments. That's basically it. That's our reusable contact control. So now let's try to use it. Go back to the edit contact page, and then let's see how we can use the reusable control. First of all, to use this new control, we need to provide a namespace, because if we just type the control name, right, contact control, it's not defined here. So let's go to here, and then we're going to say controls. Again, whatever name you choose, I'm choosing controls. And then it's under controls. So we can find it right here. Then we can say controls, providing the namespace. Well, it's already showing up, right? All of them already showing up. There's only one. And then we can give it a name. And we can call it contact control. And then we're going to register a unsave event handler here. And we're going to create a new one. Actually, we're not going to create a new one. We're going to reuse one because there's already one. So it's this update, right? And then here on cancel, again, we're going to reuse this one. But on error, we don't have it. We can create a new event handler, right? And that's it. You can see it is very, very simple on the front end. Go back to the back end. It's even simpler because we are reusing these event handlers. This unsafe, we don't use it anymore. We don't use it. We can delete it. The only thing that needs to be changed is here. We don't have the entry views anymore. So what we can do is we can say contact control contract. I used the wrong names. It should be contact instead of contract, right? Contact control. So go back here. We need to fix this as well. Contact control on error. Okay. So here we're going to say contact control dot name, right? And then this is going to be contact control dot address and contact control dot email. Last but not least, contact control dot phone number. Okay. And then here the validations don't need to be happening here anymore because this event handler will only be invoked or triggered when the validation has finished, right, has passed. What we do need to change is these assignments. So I can just delete all of them. And then I'm going to copy from here and paste it over here. Okay. And then just fix the problems. Okay. So now on error, what do we need to do when we encounter an error? This is a string which contains the error message. So of course, we just use the display alert from the page class, and then title is going to be error as usual. Message is just the message, right? And then cancel is okay button. So that's it. That's how we use our reusable contact control. Let's give it a test. Okay, you can see the application is running. Let's click on any one of them. And now we see the added contact page. No difference. Let's try to see whether we can update. I put a dot there, but let me actually delete the at sign. Just try to trigger the validation problem. Right? So email format is invalid. So that's validation is going on properly. Let's also try to delete the whole thing and then click on save. This time it tells us not only the format is invalid, but also it's required. So let's put back the email address. So john.doe@gmail.com and then click on the save button. Now I have john.doe@gmail.com. Going back, phone number is whatever. Right, address is 1, let's say Toronto Street. Click on save button. And everything is basically still working, right? But this time we're using our reusable contact control. In the next video, we're going to use the control, right, the contact control in the add contact page. And we're going to work on adding contact. I'll see you in the next one. In this video, we're going to work on the Add Contact page. But first of all, going to the Add Contact page is triggered from the Contacts page. Right? So this is the Contacts page I'm looking at right now. And it has a list view. And a list view is just a single view. So we really need to have a list view in a layout. So we have talked about the stack layout before. Today, instead of using stack layout, I would like to use the grid so that we can learn more things. So a grid is basically like a table. It has columns and rows, right? So if I put a grid here, so if I don't specify columns or rows, then you can basically just put a list view here, right? One view is going to still work. You're not actually using a grid as a grid, right? To use it properly, we need to define like how many columns and how many rows and how big each column or rows are, right? For that, we need two properties. One is called row definition. So you can see row definitions. And for this particular page, we are going to have the list view in the first row, and then a button, which is the add button, in the second row. So we have two rows. So here we basically, in the row definition, we just specify the height, like X, Y, Z. So in this case, we have three rows, and the first row's height is X, the second row's height is Y, and of course the last row's height is Z. But what about you don't want to actually specify a specific number? You just want to say the last row is, for example, 50, and then the first row takes the rest of the space. Then you can just say star, right? Star means it takes as much as it can. And then we can specify the column definition. How many columns do we have, and how big is each column, right? So it's the same format, X, Y, Z. Each one of them has to be a number. You can see that it's complaining. You cannot use X, Y, Z because it doesn't really know how big what each one column is. So in this case, we actually only have one column, right? And then in the list view or inside the grid, we need to specify which row and column each view is within. So the list view is in row number one and column number one. So we can just say grid dot row number one. This is the index starting from zero. So basically when we refer to the first row, we're gonna say zero, right? And then of course the column is also zero. Now, when it comes to the second one, which is going to be a button, and we'll give it a name first. This is going to be a add button. And the text is add contact, for example. And we are going to add a clicked event handler since we're here already. Okay. But this button needs to be in the second row and first column. So we're going to say grade.row second row is number one, and grade.column, and it's going to be zero, the first call. All right, let's run the application and see whether we have a correct page. We can't see anything in the application, but I noticed that I made a mistake here. This is not number of columns. This is how big the column is because we only have one, so we can use star because this column should expand to as much as it should, right? So now we can see all of the data. In the backend, let's go to the view code. We have this add event handler. Here we want to navigate to our add contact page. Okay. So let's continue working on coding the add contact page. So let's go to add contact page. There's basically this welcome page, right? So there's basically nothing in it. It does have a cancel button. So we don't need any of this because the contact control already has a cancel button and it has everything else that we need. So basically we can go to the edit contact page and we can just copy this and go back to add contact page, and then we just replace this, replace everything. And of course the namespace also needs to be added, so we can go to the top and then we can specify, you know, the controls come from the controls, which is right here, and now the problem is fixed. So unsafe needs to be recreated, the event handler, new handler, uncancel, new handler, and onError also needs to be created, new event handler. That's it at the front end, very simple. That's the beauty of creating a reusable control. We don't do a lot of work because all of the work already been done, right? Going back to the backend, unsafe. So what should we do on unsafe? We need to call the repository to add the new contact. But do we already have a add method here? We don't. So first of all, we need to create a add contact method. So here we create a static method, and then we're gonna, it's gonna be void, and gonna call it add contact, and of course the parameter is a contact, and then we are going to, first of all, we need to get the maximum ID, right? Remember, this is a in memory, so in-memory data store, so we need to manually get the ID. So we need to get the contact ID, the maximum contact ID, right? And then we can say contact.contactID. So we assign the ID to it. So it's maximum ID plus one, right? And after that, we can just add this contact into the contacts list. Okay, so that's it. That's our method, very simple method without much validation. You know, if we add a duplicate contact, we can always try to delete it, which we're going to work on later. So coming back to the add contact page, inside save event handler, we can use the contact repository. And then we can call the add contact. And of course, here we need to create a new contact. Okay, just like this, and then we can specify that name equals to contact control dot name, right? Remember that we exposed all of the property out, and then Visual Studio is suggesting email equals to email. I hope it actually suggests the next one, but it doesn't always help, but it's already helping a little bit. Then we just specify address is address and phone is phone. And then we close with a semicolon. So that's our add contact. Remember here, when it comes to this method, everything's already validated, right? It's a valid contact. And then if there is an error, then this on error event handler will be triggered. And the only thing we need to do here is just to display the error message. Right, so we can say display alert, and the title is error, message is from the event argument, and the cancel button is okay. Right, so this E is the error message, which comes from the parameter here, which is the event arguments of that event handler. And then of course the shell, the onCancel event handler, just basically, you know, go back. We can just shell.current. Go to async. And where are we going? We are going back to the contact page. We can use dot dot, but if not, then we can use, we specify the root, right? And then we can say name of, I think we already have a console. So in here we created a new event handler. That's fine, we can just copy this over. Okay, so when we go to the root, we always try to specify slash slash. Or if we don't, then we can use dot dot to navigate back to the previous page, right? To the parent page. So I think that's everything. Let's give it a try. I notice a problem here that after this add contact, we need to navigate back to the contacts page. So I just duplicated this line here. Okay, now let's give it a try. Okay, so we have this list of contacts, and then we can click on any of them. Going to the added contact page, still working. Now let's test the add contact page. So I think we're having some problems here with the layout. Okay, so let's try to fix the layout problem first. Because the hot reload actually works for the front end, so we don't have to stop. So we can fix that very quickly. Go to the contacts page here. I think we need to add some paddings for the grid, because you can see the button is not positioned properly. So let's add some padding. So let's add maybe 5. Let's see how it looks like. Now it looks much better. You can see that everything is positioned correctly. So clicking on the add contact button, this should take us to the add contact page. Now you can see we have all of this. Clicking on the save button, this should trigger the validations, and we should be able to see all of the validation errors. So name is required, right? So then I'm going to add, I don't know, this person's name is Monday Smith. And then clicking on the save button again to trigger the email validation. Email is required and format has to be correct. So let's call it just smith@gmail.com. In the spirit of testing, I'm providing a wrong format. So then it's actually validating it. And then phone number is optional, address is optional, so I'm just going to provide something. Clicking on the save button, going back, we can see Monday Smith. Okay, so it's working beautifully. So again, let's take a look what we have done. Go to the add contact page. You can see that we basically did almost nothing. Right, just reusing the functionality that we already created. So this is the beauty of using a reusable control. Okay, so that's everything I want to cover in this video. I'll see you in the next one. For our contacts application, the next step is to be able to delete a contact within the contact list. Right, so let's go to the contacts page, and we can see that we have this list view. And then within the list view, we have this item template, which is basically a text cell. So we can kind of add a button there by using view cell instead of text cell, because within the view cell, you can place a whatever view you want, even a stack layout, right? We can use a horizontal stack layout and put a button there. But list view has a context action. And within context actions, you can put one or more menu items. So instead of using buttons, I think we should learn about using context actions. So let's do that first of all. So we have this text cell, right? So within this element, let's actually format it a little bit better. Let's scroll up a little and then minimize solution explorer. So here within the text cell, we can say text cell dot context actions, right? And then within this context action, then we can add menu items. And for example, we can have a delete, which is exactly the functionality we want, right? We can have multiple ones. Let's say text, maybe let's say instead of using tab to edit or view the contact item, we can have the edit button right here. For example, well, I'm just showing there's possibility of having multiple menu items. And then if we run our application, let's see how it looks like how the context menu looks like. Okay, you can see our application is running. If we want to trigger the context menu, what we need to do is long press. And you can see the context menu is showing up on the top. On different devices, it may look different. On Windows, the context menu is actually showing right here, just like a regular Windows application. Right? On Android, it's showing on the top. For our application, context application, we are going to delete this edit. We're only going to have this delete right here. And you can see immediately the edit context menu is gone and delete is here. So when I click on it, nothing is happening. That's because nothing is implemented for delete. Before I go ahead and implement delete functionality, there's one more thing I want to point out, which is for the menu items. There is a property here and it says is destructive. So if we set this to true, you can actually see on Android, nothing is special. So delete is delete. But on other devices like iOS, I believe, this delete menu item will be displayed in red, right? Because it's destructive. Here, nothing is happening in Android. Okay. To react to this delete event, what we can do is we can add a event handler to the click event, right? So clicked event, and then we can just say new event handler. Okay. All right. So then at the back end, you can see a new event is added, but how do we know which contact triggered the context menu? So we will need to use the data binding. As we mentioned before, the data binding in ListView is by binding context. So for each item, see here it's item template. So for each item, the binding context is the contact itself. So go back to the backend. Let's review that. We have a list of contact here, right? It's an observation list, but it's still a list, right? So we have a list of contact and each item within that list is a contact object, right? So here, the binding context for this, for the entire item template is the contact object itself. So therefore, what we can do here is to say command parameter, command parameter. And then we are going to use a binding again, but this time we're going to use it a little bit differently. We're going to say dot. What does dot mean? This dot refers to the object that is bound to this current item, right? So instead of going like drilling down into which property we're binding to, we're actually just binding to the entire object, which is the contact object, right? And after that, we can go to our backend and go here. Now we can retrieve the contact object directly from here by saying var menu item, right? And sender, so who sent it? It's a menu item, right? Because we clicked on the menu item is the sender. And then we can cast a menu item dot command parameter to contact object. Right, so now we have a contact object. And then we are going to run the delete functionality. So, but we don't have a delete functionality yet. So let's go to our models and contact repository, and then let's add our delete functionality in here. Okay, so it's going to be pretty simple. We are going to say delete contact, and then here, instead of passing the entire contact object, we don't actually need it. We can just pass the contact ID. Of course, in the data binding, we don't have to use binding dot. We can just say binding contact ID, right? But I want to show you there's actually this way of binding the current object, right? So here we're trying to get the contact by ID, And to do that, we can just use lambda expression just like before. We can say contact ID equals contact ID. And if the contact is not null, then we are going to actually remove this. Right, we're going to remove this contact object. Okay, so that's the functionality in here. So we did that, and then let's go back to our code behind and let's look at this menu item click. So we have this contact. Now we can use our contact repository, and then we can call the delete contact method that we just added, and then we can say contact.contactID. And that's good enough, right? That's good enough. But if we run it, guess what's going to happen? Contact will be deleted from the contact list. However, you won't see a change in the list view. Why is that? Because we didn't actually refresh the list view. Remember, the contact list in memory and the contact list in the list view are two different things. And we have to notify the list view that we have a change. That's why we need to do something like, let's go up here in the onAppearing. We have this these two lines of code here, right, which will kind of force a refreshing. So we will need to extract this out to in a different method, like in a private helper method, and we're gonna call it load contacts. Okay, so here we're just going to paste these two lines in here, and then go up over here. We're gonna call the contacts load contacts, and of course, inside the delete functionality here, we're gonna also call the load contacts. Here, I don't like calling it menu item clicked. Right, because it's not actually clear what is actually happening. Let's actually call it delete clicked. Okay, so let's go back, and then here let's change that to delete clicked. Maybe we can just delete the whole thing, and then here we can select delete clicked. I don't know why it's complaining. It's saying that delete clicked is not found. That's pretty weird. So we have this delete clicked right here. I think it's just, because we are still running the application. Okay, so let's stop it, and then that should resolve the problem. Okay, so let's, we completed our coding for delete contact. Let's run the application again to see whether it works. All right, so let's try to delete, let's say the first one. So long click, and then click on delete, and then you can see that it's gone, right? So delete. That's what I want to cover in this video. In this video, we're going to work on search contacts functionality because we already implemented view contacts, add contacts, delete contacts, and update contacts. So now we just need the final functionality, which is to search contacts, because we may have lots of contacts and it would be nice to be able to search and find the contacts that we're looking for. Right. So for that, let's go into the contacts page. Right. So contacts page. Right now you can see that we have a grid, and then inside the grid, we have a list view and a button. Right. So a search bar should be put on the top. Right, so we can have a search bar here, and in .NET MAUI there is actually a search bar already. You can actually see it right here, right? So in order to display the search bar, we have to change our grid so that instead of having two rows, now we need three rows. So we can put like 50, right? So the first row is for the search bar, which the height of that is about 50. And then the second one is going to be as big as it can get to. And then the last one is where the add contact button is located. So that one also has 50, right? So we can do that. And then we need to change, let's copy these two properties here or attributes, and then put it inside here
on the search bar. That would be good. And then we need to change the row for the list view, and as well as the row for the button, which is number 2. Okay, now we should be able to display the search bar, and we need to let the user know that this is actually a search bar. For that, the placeholder attribute is the best attribute to use, and we can say something like search contact, right? So the user know that this bar is for searching contacts. And in order to react to the search, there are a couple of events we can take advantage of. One of them is text changed, right? So this event, so let's actually have this one, as well as there is a search button pressed. So there are two events that it's that can be used, right? I would prefer to use the text changed, because the text changed event is triggered whenever you actually type anything, right? So this is different from for example, a web application where you try to trigger a text change. So the text is only changed when the cursor leaves the input box, right? Here, while you're typing, the event is actually triggered. Whereas the search button pressed, usually is gonna show, for example, a magnifying glass in the search bar. And then when you press on that or tap on that magnifying glass, then this event is triggered. So I don't like it because it's not very intuitive. So let's actually delete this one. Okay, and then let's go back to the front end and also delete this one. But if that's your requirement that you have to press on the magnifying glass, then yeah, you can feel free to use that. But for us, we're gonna use a text changed event. And then in the text change event, so let's go back to the code behind, we will have to use the context repository, right? This is a temporary repository that we're using to load in-memory data, right? So we can use context repository, but we don't actually have a search functionality yet, right? We don't have that yet, but we don't have it, but we can code it here. So what needs to be inside the search contact functionality, actually let's call it search contacts. So this has to be whatever that is the user typed in the search bar, right? For that, we can get it from the sender, because the sender is actually the search bar. So we can say search bar sender. So this is casting the sender to the search bar, and then the text is what the user entered. So this is good enough. And this should return us the list of contacts, right? So we will have the contacts here, and then look at the load contacts, right? So we have this contacts here, but then this contacts is different. So we will need to use the observable collection, and then we can wrap around like this. So then this context is a observable context, right? And then we can just copy this line and put it over here, and that's it. That's it. And the rest of the work is just implement the search context method or actually function. Okay, so let's copy the search context and go to the context repository, go down to the bottom, and then we're gonna create another public static function, which is going to return a list of contacts, and that would be similar to this one, right? So it's going to be list of contact, and then here we're going to call it search contacts, and this is basically filter text, you can call it whatever. And then here inside the contacts, we can just basically say where X name starts with filter text, and then we can say string comparison ordinal ignore case. Okay, so we want to ignore case. We want it to be case insensitive, right? And this is going to return us a enumerable And we can cast it into a list like that. So we can do to list contacts. So here we're only looking at the name, but we actually should enable the user to search by anything, right? The name, phone number, address, or email address. So we actually need to, let's actually copy and paste this line. And then we can test the other three fields here. So what we need to say here is that if the contacts, sorry, not contact, but contacts, if it's not null, and also if contacts.count is actually it, if it's null or contacts.count less or equal to zero, that means we didn't find anything. So in this case, we'll have to find we'll have to look for the filter tags in some other fields, right? So let's say the second one we're looking at is email, right? And if otherwise, if we did find something from the first query, then we just return, right? And we are going to do the same thing over and over again for another two times, right? So here we are going to say this is a phone number maybe, okay? And last but not least, we're looking at address. So we can see that if we ever run to this line, then the result is not returned. So therefore, we will have to, at the end, return a contact just like this. And this contact at the end can be an empty list.
Another thing we need to pay attention to is that one of these ones can be null, right? Name, email, phone number, or addresses can be null. So in order to solve that problem, we actually have to add some condition over here. Otherwise, it's going to throw like object reference, like null reference problem. We can use a condition over here to say is null or empty or white space. Okay, so the x dot name here has to be not empty, and it has to start with the filter tags. Okay, and then we're gonna apply the same condition to the other ones. I'm gonna put over here. Of course, this has to be changed to email. And this is phone number, and this one is address. Okay, so the condition is it's not null or empty, and it starts with the contacts, the filter text. Then that satisfies the criteria, and we'll get our contact back, the correct contacts back.
Here, where we have our search text changed, search bar text changed. And you can see that the problem is gone, and we should be able to just use this. So let's run our application and see whether it works or not. Okay, so now we can see our search contacts. Bar is right here. So let's type in the first character, J. Actually, let's put a breakpoint over here and just make sure that the event is actually triggered while we're typing. Right, so I'm gonna use the soft keyboard, like the virtual one. So I'm putting J here, and you can see this immediately trigger, right? It doesn't actually need the cursor to actually leave. But you may thinking that I press here, so the cursor actually left. Well, it's actually not the case. So actually, let's continue. So I'm gonna press on F5. So let's continue, right? Let's actually delete this, right? Basically clear the box, and you can see it's also triggered right away. Right. And then now it's cleared. So instead of using the soft keyboard, I'm just going to type the letter J right inside, like with my keyboard. So I tap J, and now you can see that the breakpoint is triggered. That just proves that the text change event is not triggered when the cursor leaves the search bar. Right. So I press on F5. So continue. Right. So I type in JA. Now I can see Jane Doe. So the search actually works, right? and then I can type in Jane, tap on Jane Doe and go to see the details of Jane Doe, right? Go cancel button, takes us back to here. Unfortunately, the search bar didn't actually clear and everything is still showing, right? So for that purpose, what we can do is that on appearing here, we can do some house cleaning here. We can say that search bar, actually we didn't give it a name yet. Did we go back to contact? So let's stop this and go back to contacts. We didn't give it a name yet. So we can say name equals, just call it search bar. Okay. So here we can say search bar dot text equals string dot empty. Okay. So with this change, let's give it a test again. All right, so now let's go to, I should go to myself, Frank, and then click on my contact and click on cancel button. Now you can see that the search bar is cleared. Okay, so that's the functionality I want to cover today. I'll see you in the next one.